Justice Mendoza?
I defer to Justice Abad.
Justice Abad.
Counsel, I'd like to be clarified on the meaning or exact meaning of abortion, because my reading of the law is that there is abortion when the there's a prevention of the fertilized ovum to reach and be implanted in the mother's womb. This is the what the law says.
That is not, Your Honor, a definition of abortion. It is a definition of abortifacient.
Yes, well,
because an abortion means that there is a fetus which is expelled from the uterus before it becomes viable.
Well, but as far as this
in this, in this particular case, Your Honor, prevention of implantation, there is yet no fetus in the mother's womb.
Well, as far as the law is concerned, what is the correct definition of abortion?
The law did not define abortion, Your Honor.
But what's your understanding of it under this law?
Well, under this law, Your Honor, abortion is the expulsion of the embryo or fetus from the mother's womb before it becomes viable.
Ah, okay. So, now, there's a question on, you said that the FDA will determine whether a product or supply is an abortive patient. But there's a, from the discussion during the last hearing, contraceptives or hormonal contraceptives or IUDs sometimes function also as abortive patient, in the sense that now even with the try to prevent ovulation, ovulation takes place, tries to prevent fertilization, it takes place. When it takes place, the contraceptive works a third function, which is to abort, to prevent the fertilized egg from implanting effectively on the endometrium. So, how will the FDA, that's not in the law, no? How will the FDA apply this principle? Will it assume only or pass as not abortive patient those that have merely secondary function, or only on the basis of their primary functions?
The secondary function or mechanism of contraceptives, which is reportedly preventing the implantation of the fertilized ovum in the mother's womb, is not yet medically validated. But as a concession to the critics of the Arits Bill, we accepted their definition of abortifacients to include drugs and devices which will prevent the implantation of the fertilized ovum in the uterus.
I see. Well, that will, from my reading, that will practically exclude all hormonal contraceptives and IUDs.
No, Your Honor, because no? Principally, the hormonal contraceptives would prevent fertilization either by inhibiting ovulation or preventing the sperm from fertilizing the egg.
But what you're saying now is not in the law, no? That's not the law. That's your thinking. But the law does not say that the FDA should consider as abortive patients contraceptives that have secondary function of causing abortion.
That is in the law, Your Honor. I was the one who amended the proposition of the critics of the bill.
What section of the law? Because I
the section 4A. Which says, upon section 4A, which says, upon determination of the FDA.
Okay, so, now, you said that one of the reasons for this law is the consideration that of the maternal mortality in the Philippines as well. Well, from Bill Gates and Melinda Gates Foundation study made to the Philippines and other countries, it says the maternal mortality ratio in the Philippines is declining. 443 per 100,000 in 1980, 174 per 100,000 in 1990, 103 per 100,000 in 2000, and 84 cases per 100,000 in 2008. That's what the study says. So just imagine that with this number, there are about, from my estimate, there are about 23 million childbearing ages women in the Philippines. So if you just say half of them will take these contraceptives because of this law, that will be about 11 million or 12 million. So we will put intrauterine devices in 12 million women to avoid these 84 deaths out of 100,000, put them at the risk of, I'm reading from WHO, irregular bleeding during menstruation, headaches, increased risk of pelvic inflammatory disease, perforation occurs in the uterus, unexpected pregnancy during IUD application, pain in the pelvic region, from WHO, cramping and pain, especially by copper IUD, impulsive expulsion, breast tenderness, vomiting, spots on skin, etc. We put 23 million of our people, of our women, to face one or some or all of these for maternal mortality that can be met actually by sufficient hospital facilities. These deaths really could have been prevented if blood were available in the clinics, there are competent doctors on hand, they would have been prevented. But your cure is contraceptives for 23 million childbearing women in the Philippines.
Well, Your Honor, in the first place, that data from Gates Foundation is not consistent with our own government data. The NSO, which says that 14 women die daily because of complications from pregnancy and childbirth. And I think we should believe our own statistics. Number two, no one is being compelled, Your Honor, to use contraceptives, to use IUDs, or even to use condoms. It is freedom of informed choice. It is the option of a woman or a couple whether to use or not contraceptives. And then, despite the findings of a sub-office of the WHO of this risk, which are not actually life-threatening, and it is similar to other drugs and medicine, the WHO still included contraceptives in the essential list of medicine. And the WHO is the main health authority of the United Nations, to which the Philippines is a member.
The government wants to encourage and promote the use of artificial contraceptives at such cost and, as I said, at such possibility of risk of certain dangers. Yet from my reading from the WHO reports, there are actually other options, like, for example, although the Catholic Church will not approve this, but male condom is 98% good with correct and consistent use. It says there. And 85% as commonly used. So what we need is to teach them correct and consistent use. That's another one. Withdrawal, 96% with correct and consistent use. 73% as commonly used. Fertility awareness, I think this is the natural method. 95 to 97% with correct and consistent use. So education is important. 75% as commonly used. And here's the other one. Abstinence, 100%. Because if married couples love each other, willing to make the sacrifices, and learn also the art of abstinence and love, then that will also work, isn't it? Don't you think so?
Yes, Your Honor, all of this will work, but which will work effectively?
Yes.
Your Honor, let me just say that the Arid's Law does not promote artificial methods of family planning. It promotes all methods, both the natural, the artificial, the traditional, and the modern methods of contraception and family planning.
Well, okay.
We are giving the people the option to choose. If they want to choose abstinence, then they can do so. Nobody is being compelled to choose otherwise.
Yes, that's good. Now, I remember mentioning at the last hearing the right of every person to substantive due process of law. This means that every law must have a proper governmental purpose, that the means chosen is reasonably related to such government purpose, and it does not go so far beyond the necessity of the case as to be arbitrary. A simple classroom example is a law that requires all restaurant personnel to wash their hands before handling food. Such law would not violate the requirement of substantive due process because, first, protecting public health is a proper governmental purpose. Second, the washing of hands by restaurant personnel before handling food is reasonably related to that purpose. And third, such washing of hands before handling food does not go so far beyond the necessity of the case as to be arbitrary. On the other hand, and this is the problem, if the law requires all restaurant personnel to wash their hands and further to immerse their hands in boiling water before handling food, such law would violate the requirement of substantive due process. Because although immersing the hands in boiling water would probably help clean the hands, such requirement goes so far beyond the necessity of the case as to be arbitrary or oppressive. All right. So here, in this law, the apparent purpose of the law, as stated in its title, is to promote responsible parenthood and reproductive health, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
This, you claim, is a proper governmental purpose, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
If the means chosen for attaining that purpose will enable parents to freely and responsibly decide the number and spacing of their children, then such means would be reasonable related to the purpose of the law, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Which is the promotion of responsible parenthood and reproductive health, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, those means are in the nature of washing of hands in our example, because they are related to the purpose. Now, I do not believe that anyone seriously objects to the provisions of this law requiring more public maternity hospital and clinics and adequate facilities and medical supplies, or a greater number of trained health workers. Those would be reasonably related to the purpose of the law, correct? These more facilities will help promote the purpose of the law.
Yes, Your Honor. That would be another solution to the problem, but that is a more expensive solution to the problem because, as we have said, family planning and reproductive health are cost-effective.
No, but the law, from my reading from your law, is asking for better facilities for government.
Yes, Your Honor. That is in addition to the promotion of reproductive health and family planning.
Okay. to me, the real issue, the real contention here, is the RH law's adoption of certain means that would promote and ensure the massive distribution and use of hormonal contraceptives and intrauterine devices to people from age 10 and above. I want to know if these means are reasonable, the wash your hands kind, or are arbitrary, the boil your hands kind. So, several provisions of the law speaks of safe and non-abortive patient family planning products and supplies that parents and individuals can use. Is that correct? There's something those in the law.
Yes, Your Honor. What is being promoted now, are contraceptives, which are...
There would be nothing essentially wrong ensuring use of only safe and non-abortive patient products. Is that right?
There's nothing wrong with that.
Does the law itself say what specific family planning products and supplies it considers safe and non-abortive patient?
Well, Your Honor, under Section 9 of the RH law, it is a wrong impression to conclude that Congress declared certain contraceptives like hormonal pills, IUDs, and the like as safe, legal, and non-abortive patient. The Congress did not do that, Your Honor. What the Congress said is that the Philippine National Drug Formulary should include drugs and devices which are considered as contraceptives, like hormonal pills, IUDs, and the like, provided that they are safe, medically safe, legal, and non-abortive patient. In other words, Congress gave a standard which the FDA must follow in its registering and approving what are contraceptives which are not abortive patient.
Well, maybe that's your understanding bit, but may I just go over the law, no? It says, Section 9, the National Drug Formulary shall include hormonal contraceptives, intrauterine devices, injectables, and other safe, legal, non-abortive patient, and effective family planning products and supplies. The law uses the word shall include, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
Counsel, yeah.
Shall include.
Meaning that by force of law, all hormonal contraceptives and intrauterine devices, their products and supplies, are safe and non-abortive patient, and therefore are to be included in the National Drug Formulary. Is that correct?
We regret that we cannot agree with the conclusion of Your Honor, because what the law says, and I quote, the National Drug Formulary shall include hormonal contraceptives, intrauterine devices, injectables, and other safe, legal, non-abortive patient, and effective family planning products and supplies. The provision on safe, legal, non-abortive patient, effective family planning products and supply is not a declaration by Congress that the previous enumeration are safe, legal, and non-abortive patient. Well, it only says that the FDA should follow this standard in determining whether this hormonal contraceptives,
well, let me go devices, the law says
injectables,
yes,
are to be part of the National Drug Formulary.
No, the law says, from my reading, the law says that these artificial contraceptives shall be included, so it's a command, no? Shall be included in the National Formulary, Drugs Formulary. And under the law, that means that is the same as the essential drugs list. of the country, that's the same. And if a product or a supply is in the essential drugs list, it means that it is available to the public. It is to be purchased by the government for the distribution free to those who may be in need of it. There's nothing there that says, and the only role that was given to the FDA there in the same section is that the FDA shall merely issue a certification that those who buy this or something should not use them as abortive patient. And let me see, do you agree with the Solicitor General said in his comment that Section 9 is a legislative finding of fact based on scientific evidence in the hands of Congress that these artificial contraceptives are safe and non-abortive patient products and supplies, page 31 of the OSG comment. Actually, my reading is the same as the OSG. This is our reading, so you have another interpretation.
Yeah, Your Honor, it is true that medical researches and findings were submitted to Congress when we deliberated on this particular section. But, Your Honor, neither Your Honor or the Solicitor General was in the midst or in the thick of the deliberations of this particular section. I was there, Your Honor, and this is the intention of Congress.
Well, the problem is that even your colleagues who voted on it in the Senate and the House of Representatives would, of course, be reading the bill as final, the wordings of it. It will not be reading your mind. That's just as we are. Yeah, we are not bound by your impression.
That's right, Your Honor.
Even the Solicitor General who represents the government and Congress, he represents government, the Congress says that this finding is a binding legislative declaration.
Your Honor.
That hormonal contraceptives and IUDs are safe and non-abortive patient. And nobody, you said even the Supreme Court should defer to it. That's what OSG says.
Your Honor, just on the question on when life begins, well, Congress doesn't have the competence. Congress doesn't have the competence to decide and to declare that certain contraceptives like hormonal contraceptives, intrauterine devices, injectables are safe, legal, and non-abortive.
I'm glad you accept that. No?
This is not the jurisdiction of Congress. It is the jurisdiction of the an administrative agency which has the competence to do that.
But those who will enforce the law, the government itself, represented by the Solicitor General, understands it as this, you know, as legislature telling us that these drugs are safe and non-abortive patient. And you know, I recall I was reading a pocket book that my dad saved, I think before the invention of penicillin. And there appears there an article that says that the best cure for syphilis was cyanide during that time. Huh? But later on, penicillin was discovered. But if our Congress declared that as the cure to syphilis, we will be in trouble. Huh? So now, we have here a legislative declaration that hormonal contraceptives and uterine devices are safe and not abortive patient. If the Supreme Court upholds this law, that will be binding on all government agencies, even on the Supreme Court in the future decisions, on all prosecutors and policemen. And they will act accordingly. But as we know, these matters, scientific propositions, are changing all the time. They are changing all the time. We need to repeal this law if it turns out that it is false.
Precisely, Your Honor, because the frontier of science is unlimited. And medical science would advance on a daily basis. That's why Congress did not define, did not declare that these contraceptives are legal and non-abortive.
Therefore, we should annul this Section 9 because it says differently from what you're saying.
No, Your Honor, it does not say differently. It's what's, what well, it, it is your conclusion which is different from the intention of the members of Congress, Your Honor.
I'll see. Well, anyway, so there's a problem there, no? Section 23 makes it a crime for any healthcare service provider, public or private, to intentionally provide correct information regarding a full range of legal, medically safe, non-abortive family planning methods. Yung mga doctor at nurses, bawal magbigay ng maling salita tungkol sa contraceptives. Ah, ganun, ganun ba, counsel? They cannot give incorrect information, and that will be punished by law.
It says knowingly, Your Honor.
It says incorrect information.
Yeah, knowingly.
Knowingly,
giving incorrect information.
If this law is upheld by the court, the assumption is that the doctors have read Section 9 that says that hormonal contraceptives and IUDs are safe and non-abortive, and then they are bound by that knowledge. You agree?
They are bound by the declaration.
They are bound by what the law says.
No, they are bound by the declaration of the Food and Drug Administration on what are
not
legal.
By the law, but by the... Because how about this provision of the law? They can ignore
the law,
that?
The law delegated that authority to the appropriate government agency, which has the competence to determine.
So, if the doctor tells his patient that the oral pills the patient wants is not safe or free of any danger, contrary to what the law says that it is safe, the doctor will be giving him information that the law regards as incorrect. Yes?
Well, Your Honor, it would be on a case-to-case basis. It all depends on the circumstances on during which that particular information was given by
so
the doctor.
There are a lot of things to look for.
Yes, Your Honor, because it's all evidential.
But you know, a law that punishes cannot be vague. A law that punishes cannot leave things to the police officer to determine what will constitute a crime. Law must clearly say the acts that could constitute a crime. That's the basic in criminal law.
The law is not vague, Your Honor. It defines what is prohibited. But whether a person is accused
of
violating the law is culpable or not is a matter of evidence.
No, let me ask you, does the law define the meaning of incorrect information? It does not.
Well, there is no need to define that, Your Honor, because that has an ordinary meaning.
Well, but as you said, scientific propositions, medical propositions are changing. No? So police officers have to read the developments in medicine all the time to determine whether there's a violation of this. We will be placing ourselves at the mercy of law enforcers who will determine whether at a proper time this is correct or incorrect.
In the final analysis, it would not be the police enforcer who is going to determine the culpability or innocence of a person accused under this law. It would be the courts.
Well, initially, the police officers, the law enforcers are the ones to determine for filing the case in court. Anyway, suppose the doctor discourages his patient from using oral pills and copper IUD, not because of any religious belief, but simply because, as a doctor, he taught them to unsafe, contrary to what the law says. Can the doctor go to jail?
Well, Your Honor, again, it's a matter of evidence, you know. It all depends on how this advice or counsel was given by the doctor and what was the condition of the patient. It is possible that the patient has health
problems. No, supposing the patient, there's nothing wrong with the patient. So the doctor must have to advise him that this is safe for him or her. contraceptive, artificial contraceptives?
If the doctor knowingly say, made that wrong information to a patient who is entitled to use contraceptives, then the doctor should suffer the consequences of his culpable and incorrect advice.
Why even entitled? A patient will say, I'm entitled to... Patients usually go for consultation because they know not... don't really know anything. So he will trust in the competence and wisdom of the doctor. And the doctor says, well, I don't believe that these are safe. The law says they are safe, but I don't believe that. So I'll not advise you. So the doctor will go to jail.
Well, if the evidence would sustain his guilt, then so be it.
Yes, okay. So, but if the government wants to promote oral pills and copper IUDs that it believes are safe and non-abortive patient, should it not compete in the marketplace of scientific ideas and not proclaim by law that this is the only correct idea, that these contraceptives are safe and non-abortive patient?
There is no such proclamation by Congress, Your Honor.
Mm-hmm. No. Under Section 2 of the RH law, the state guarantees the right of individuals to information they need to make decisions for themselves. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Also, Section 3, guiding principles for the implementation of the law, is to the same tenor, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Is the question of whether or not artificial contraceptives are safe and non-abortive patient a matter of public concern?
Definitely, Your Honor.
Well, Section 7 of Article 3 of the Constitution provides that the right of the people to information on matters of public concern shall be recognized. You get that?
Yeah, that's section...
Under Section 7 of the Constitution, no?
Yes.
The right of the people to information on matters of public concern shall be recognized. Now, but since Section 9... in effect, tags as incorrect any view and will punish views that the government has adopted as correct. It seems to me that this violates the right of the people to information on matters of public concern if other ideas are barred, even erroneous ideas are barred. You see, incorrect information will be punished. So this law will only protect correct information approved by the government and not allow for any other incorrect information.
Well, the law provides for the dissemination of correct information.
Yeah, well, no, that's your best answer now. Does not
why
the right
the law,
of a person
encourage the dissemination why should the law have a provision that incorrect information should be circulated? You know,
incorrect. Correct. What is correct? Incorrect will be decided by the government.
Yes, Your Honor. And eventually,
the truth. Well, we have a problem. You know, if we rely on the government for what is correct and incorrect. Well, I think people should be able to think for themselves also what is correct and incorrect. Don't you agree?
The government has adopted a particular public policy. And the policy is the promotion of responsible parenthood and reproductive health. And also the promotion of all methods of family planning, which are medically safe, legal, effective, and non-abortive.
Okay, well, that's your best answer. Now, does not the right of a person to make a choice in relation to reproductive health imply a right to seek advice from one he trusts.
Yes, Your Honor.
Suppose a woman wanting a space to space her pregnancy, especially seeks the advice from a physician whom she trusts, and the latter, a Catholic, expresses his belief that taking oral pills or using copper iodides is evil. Would this physician go to jail for giving such advice?
Well, that could form part of the lost respect for religious freedom. And so the woman can get a second opinion from another doctor.
My question is, does this doctor who tells this incorrect information go to jail?
Well, if that could come under his religious belief, then religious
belief. No, you go to him as a doctor. It happens to be a Catholic.
Yes, Your Honor. But, if that is an advice coming from a doctor, he's a Catholic, and that is his religious belief, then most probably the law would respect religious conviction and religious belief. Because
We wanted to stop religious, what they call that, dictatorship or things like that. No? That you think that it is existing.
Your Honor, I think all of these questions would be in an arena where evidence should be introduced, because it's very hard to make a hard and fast assessment and resolution of these questions.
But I gave you the facts.
The facts.
I gave you the evidence.
Well, the facts are that so treated that I think there is need. For,
no, but on those facts, I know that there may be other variables. On those facts.
Well, if that would be part of his religious belief, and the law respects religious conviction and belief, then he may not be culpable for any violation. But there is also the principle that religious freedom is a grant of religious liberty, not civil immunity. So all of this will have to come into play.
Well, I'm glad that's your interpretation, but we are bound by the language of the law. Okay. Now, religious conscience is part of the consideration for a pre-choice in family planning. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And that one can seek advice from a healthcare provider regarding the latter's religious belief. Even if he's a public doctor, in a public health center, in a government hospital, he's a Catholic doctor, he can give advice different from your official line. No.
Yes, Your Honor, if that is part of his religious conviction and belief, it is being...
No, but this is also public duty. You said he's a doctor paid by the government.
That's why, Your Honor, I am saying that we cannot just state certain facts and that's it. You have to decide on those limited facts.
No, but I gave you the facts. He's a government doctor.
Cases which reach the court cannot be resolved with that kind of constricted facts, Your Honor, because there are interplay of the medium of evidence as well as the doctrines. Like, for example, as I've said, religious freedom is a grant of religious liberty, but not civil immunity.
And an
invocation of religious freedom should not stalemate the state in not pursuing and implementing a public policy.
Well, that's true. That may be true. Huh? Actually, you cannot, exercise of religion cannot, be an inconvenience also or cause injury to other people. No, I don't think that's the position taken by the petitioners. At any rate, Section 4Q4 provides for guidance and counseling for adolescents. That is from 10 years old and upwards, yung mga nasa grade 4 at pataas. They are to be guided and counseled on the use of all methods of birth control, including, of course, oral pills and copper IUD. Is that correct?
Well, are we referring, Your Honor, to...
To Section 4Q4.
Q4, section.
Yes, sir. Guidance and counseling for adolescents on all methods of family planning.
Section 4.
So my 10-year-old granddaughter will go to school and he will be taught this, you know. Yeah, that these are safe.
This should be read in connection with the section on sexuality education, Your Honor.
Well, I don't know, but it says here merely he shall be given counseling and guidance. That's another part, no? Education, that's different. But this one is guidance and counseling. Okay. These kids from 10 years upwards are therefore to receive instruction in school that it is safe to use oral pills and copper IUDs, correct?
It should be age appropriate, Your Honor.
Because they will be taught this, because it says there are all methods of...
Yes, but I think we should be able to read the law in its entirety.
Well, what it says, that's what I should read it, what it says to me.
Well,
I'm not into other...
Can I get again the particular section,
please.
Your Honor? Or what is the particular section you are referring to, Your Honor?
I beg your pardon?
What is the particular section you are referring to?
Section 4, Q4. Section 4, letter Q, number 4.
Section 4.
Section 4. Letter Q, number 4. I think this is definition, sir.
Definition of terms.
Ah, yes.
Huh?
Section 4.
Section 4 is definition of terms, Your Honor.
Letter Q, number 4. Adolescent and youth reproductive health guidance and counseling.
Section.
Kalagay dito sa Q. The elements of reproductive health care include the following. Adolescent and youth reproductive health guidance and counseling. And adolescents start from the age of 10. So that was my question. They are going to get these instructions on IUDs and oral pills. Is that correct?
Well, it depends, Your Honor, on the age of the adolescent. Because the adolescent would range from 9 to... 10 years old to let us see. That has a definition, Your Honor.
Hanggang 17 yata itong adolescence.
It's 10 years to 19 years, Your Honor. So it should be age appropriate. You know, you don't teach IUDs and contraceptives to 10 years to 10 year old adolescents, Your Honor. It all depends on the particular age of the adolescent. That's why we have a range.
You will be surprised by the samples of teaching materials that are prepared for children of this age.
Well, I have seen samples of those, Your Honor. They are not sanctioned by the Department of Education.
Well, anyway, because it says there, no? They'll be taught about reproductive health, and reproductive health includes the use of all methods of preventing birth, according to you. So that will necessarily include contraceptives. Is that not so?
Yes, Your Honor, but it depends on the age of the adolescent.
I'm happy enough with that. So, well, suggestions often work on the immature mind. So those kids would probably believe this, what they taught them, correct?
Your Honor.
From the age of 10, they will probably believe all of this.
Well, it all depends on the teachers who would be able to impart the particular age-appropriate information. But let me just place on record that sexuality education, as validated by the United Nations and progressive countries, have beneficent effects. One, it would inculcate to adolescents proper sexual values. Two, it would delay the entry into sexual relations. Third, it would avoid multiple sexual partners. Then it would also promote abstinence before marriage, and also it would prevent the transfer of sexually transmitted diseases. These are all very beneficent results of sexuality education in connection with the provision you are citing, Your Honor. And there is no contrary evidence to those findings.
Yes, okay. So just one last point. I'm just curious. For my reading, the law punishes all acts that tend to impede the distribution and use of all these methods we're talking about. Acts like providing incorrect information about reproductive health, that's punished. Refusal to insert copper IUDs in the woman's womb for doctors and health providers without valid reason. Refusal to extend quality health care services, information on account of marital status, gender, age, religious convictions, personal circumstances or nature of work, or it also punishes official indifference to assigned task of public officials. But the law does not punish acts that violate a person's decision not to take part or take a limited part in the state's reproductive health program. For instance, the law does not punish manufacturers and distributors that sell drugs which function as abortive patients. It does not punish misleading those who may want contraceptives but reject abortion. The law does not punish those who provide contraceptive products to minors without the parents' written consent. The law does not punish those who provide guidance and counseling to adolescents without the knowledge and consent of their parents. The law does not hold manufacturers and distributors of artificial contraceptives liable for false claims and side effects that are not told to the user. You know, in the U.S., as I said, buyer had to pay about over $1 billion settlement because of false claims. And the law does not ensure recovery of damages against manufacturers, not this law that you, there's no protection, absolute. Now, the law lacks the restrictions that will prevent pushing the adolescents and the young off the edge into the slippery slope of unrestrained sexual freedom that will hurt family values and public morals. Is this not a denial of the right to equal protection?
Your Honor, those supposed violations which you have mentioned are covered by existing law. They don't have to be repeated here in the RH law.
I have not found them in other laws.
For example, there are consumer laws which would cover those incidents.
In your memorandum, please show to us those
laws, Your Honor, including the Truth in Advertising Act would also include those violations. But let me just make this point very clear. With respect to minors, the provision of the law is clear that the access of minors to modern methods is not allowed without the written consent of parents or guardians, unless the minor is already a parent or has a miscarriage. So if that is violated, then that is a penal sanction.
But you see, if you teach these young people, they say, oh, hindi nyo pa ito gagamitin, this is not available to you, you have to get your parents' consent to get them. But this is good for you. We have a recipe of things here that you can use. Hormonal contraceptives, IUDs of two kinds, etc. This will work for you in the future. You know, but you have to get parental consent because you are minors. You know, we prohibit the sale of liquor to minors. But does it ever work for us? When these things is made public, because this law places it in the essential drugs list, when even everybody will have access to it, you think it will prevent these children whom you have told that this thing will work for them, they can have sex without responsibility, will stop them from getting this? Thank you, Council.
Your Honor, I think we are working on a wrong premise that adolescents, including adults, are inherently promiscuous and would engage in irresponsible sex. I think that should not be the assumption, Your Honor.
But that is the experience of Europe and the U.S. and other countries.
No, Your Honor, there has been no validation that the advent of contraceptives would increase promiscuity. As a matter of fact, promiscuity has antedated contraceptives.